The thing I want to talk about next, which is common to both your, which is common to any LCD or any display or any OLED, is the backplane. So, and we'll talk about other displays as well. They'll have different thing that you place on top. So, an LCD would have an array of liquid crystal. OLED would have an array of, light-emitting diodes. But they will all have below them a backplane, which is consisted of transistors, which drive these either the liquid crystal or your organic LEDs. And the running horse, or the staple technology so far in the industry has been amorphous silicon, because you can deposit it very easily on glass, but it comes with a maximum mobility of one. And we talk about mobility when we talked about transistors and FinFETs, but it's equally important in something as big as display. And this mobility of one only gives you a frequency, maximum frequency of 240 hertz. Also, this amorphous silicon does not, these, so remember I told you liquid crystal, they don't need any current, they just need a voltage. So it's this amorphous silicon is okay for applying voltage. But these OLED displays, these are essentially light-emitting diodes. So it's a diode and you need to drive it with current. And if you need to drive OLED with current, you need a high current, and this amorphous silicon transistor just cannot comply, just cannot supply that amount of current which is needed to drive a OLED. So does the diode need to replace it with something else? And so this is how these backplane transistors look like. They are made in a way such that the gate is laid out first. So first you lay out the gate, then you deposit your channel. So your channel typically has been amorphous silicon, but now people are, and then you deposit your source and drain, and then etch them out and separate the source and drain. But this is wrong, this should be one. So what people are trying to replace this with is this material called IgZO, or it's essentially a doped zinc oxide. So either people are trying to replace it with metal oxides, or indium, gallium, zinc oxide, or some version of zinc oxide. They have a mobility of 5 to 10, which is 5 times higher than one. Or they are trying to replace it with, instead of amorphous silicon, replace it with polysilicon. And the four-letter acronym for that is LTPS, which stands for low temperature polysilicon. And it's low temperature because it's deposited at a low temperature initially, and that can give you a mobility of up to 50. And so this IgZO, it's currently being developed to replace amorphous silicon for the LCD display. The OLED displays, they essentially have a much higher current requirement. They also need the current to be very stable at low current levels. And these amorphous silicon or these amorphous zinc oxide transistors, they always have variability in current when you operate at low current regime. There are effects known as RTN or other variability effects. So for organic LEDs, the only option available is this low temperature polysilicon. And this is, again, I talked that LCD, all you need to do is apply a voltage. In a OLED, you actually need to drive this diode, so you need to supply it with current. And the way this low temperature polysilicon is made is that you deposit amorphous silicon and then you irradiate it with laser. So it's made using sequential laser process. So you irradiate it with multiple sequences of laser, and it converts into a polysilicon material. And this is what currently limits the size of your OLED displays, because they're not big enough lasers available that could crystallize a 9 meter square display. So that's what currently limits the size of your display. But this mobility is needed needed for your transistor, and it depends upon what resolution you want on your display and what size you want of your display. And then you have three technologies, amorphous silicon, metal oxide, and low temperature polysilicon. And all of these are eventually moving away from amorphous silicon either into metal oxide or low temperature polysilicon. So, you know, coming back to your question, so we can now compare, now that we understand these technologies a little bit, we know something how LCD works, which is used in your iPhone. We know now understand how the OLEDs work, which are used in, you know, most of the Samsung phones. We can now look at some benchmarking and, you know, try to look at, now again, revisit those terms that I threw around in the beginning. So now display technology, right? We understand IPS LCD, right? What IPS LCD means. We understand OLEDs. Also, we looked at that pentile technology. That's a way of putting twice the number, or claiming you have twice the number of pixels, especially the green pixels. So that is what is used in your Galaxy S3. Right. If you look at the pixel resolution, this is how they report. So 326 ppi for your iPhone. Your Samsung, it reports a resolution of 306 pixel per inch. But again, that 306 is only the resolution of your green. Your red and blue have much lower resolution because it uses that pentile technology. So this is retina up to 10.5. This is retina at 11.2, only for green. But if you're looking at blue and red, and if your eyes are good enough to distinguish blue and red, it's retina only when you place it 16 inch or higher away from you. Brightness, we talked about, right? So LEDs, LCDs are much more brighter. So it achieves a brightness of 500 or more. The OLEDs, they are limited by their brightness, by their by the efficiency of your LEDs. So it has half the brightness of your LCD display. But the black level, look at the black level intensity. So black level intensity in a LCD is minimum of 0.5 candela per meter square. In your S3, which uses the OLED, it's less than 0.005. So black is really black in OLED, and that gives you an outstanding contrast of more than what your even eye can distinguish. So that's a very big selling point of OLEDs. OLEDs also black curve is your standard RGB gamut. Your iPhone 4, if you look, it used to have a smaller gamut as compared to the standard one. This is again the trade-off in your LCD technology of brightness versus color. So you can have a brighter gamut in a LCD technology. You can do that by making stronger color filters, but at the same time it will reduce your brightness. So iPhone 5, finally they have, you know, achieved the exact RGB color gamut. The OLED in Galaxy S3, they always come with a color gamut which is more than what you need, because you have these OLEDs and they have very distinct primary. So you always get a much larger color gamut as compared to your LCD based display. Whether it's a good thing or not, I'm not sure, because sometimes people say it gives saturated colors, but some other people like it. The gamma, which is again you can define by your output versus input, and this is on a log scale. So your iPhone would have a very linear response with a slope of exactly 2.2. Or 2.6, actually no, 2.6 is iPhone 4. This is more 2.3, which is close to 2.2. The OLED also have a similar 2.3, but it degrades at lower intensity because it's a LED and it does not have exact linear response, so it degrades at lower light level. Viewing angle, so we talked about this. Viewing angle is much better in OLED. So if you have a LCD, if you look at 30 degree angle, you only get 57%. You degrade it by 57% or 60%. In a OLED, you only degrade it by 28%. So OLED, just by the, you know, the inherent nature of a technology, it has better viewing angle. Power, so power is actually a very interesting thing. We will have a homework problem around it. But LCD power depends upon, it depends upon the efficiency of how efficiently you can get out the light you generated from your backlight. In OLED, it depends upon the efficiency of your OLEDs, And this is currently high, but it has been going down very steadily because OLEDs, the LEDs themselves are getting better and better with each technology generation. So it would be a very interesting, you know, proposition a few years from now, because OLEDs are getting better and better in terms of their efficiency. Spectra. So, you know, it's election time, so it's we should have a poll and a quiz. So the thing is, if you have an image like this, you know, on your smartphone, which is mostly black and it has a slight tinge of white text in middle, the question is which for the same brightness, what will consume less power to generate this image? Would it be a OLED or would it be LCD? So how many people think that OLED will consume less power for generating this image? And how many people think it's LCD? So the thing is, most of this, the peculiar thing about this image is that it's mostly black. So if it's mostly black, my OLED doesn't have to do anything, right? It just turns off and it's black, right? If I'm LCD, I have to essentially turn on all my all my three pixels to generate the black, right? So it's a white backlight, and to generate black, I have to turn on all my pixels, right? So for an image like this, OLED display will have, it just consumes 40% of the power that your LCD consumes. So what about this image? So if I took this image and, you know, generate the same image using either an OLED or generate using the same image using an LCD. So how many think OLED would be more power efficient in generating that kind of image? So for an image like this, your OLED consumes thrice the power of your LCD, because for your OLED, you know, that has to turn on each of those pixels to generate these lights. So by the way, you know, if you look at most of the default wallpapers that comes with your S3, they have a texture like this. Most of your default wallpapers that come in your iPhone, they have a texture which is more bright because it just suited that way. So I'm going to go 5 minutes over, but I want to mention, you know, the emerging display technologies which are out there. So there's a lot of stuff going on which is going to come out. Some of it is already out, and there's some X factors to it, you know, which make it very appealing. So both LEDs, both OLEDs and LCD, they're not sunlight readable because they work on the principle that you generate light from the surface. So if you have a light background light which is strong, which can easily diminish off the, so I talked about the LCD has a intensity of 500 candela per meter square, right? Sunlight is 10 times of that. So if you just take it out and then sunlight, you cannot, you know, neither of your Samsung or your iPhone would work in a sunlight. So you need to make it sunlight readable. Flexible display is something, you know, which has been always talked about. It never shows up to the party, but this is something which is out there, electrophoric display. So this is what you use in your Kindle, your old Kindle, although Amazon has started to move away from it. But how this works, it has, again, the backplane is same for all these new emerging displays. The way it works is that you have these dioxide and carbon dyes, and you apply a voltage. And depending upon what voltage you apply, you either get a black or a white surface. It's stable once you remove the voltage, so it requires no power in standby. E-ink makes it, and it's very slow to switch, so you can switch it one page in 30 seconds. So, and also it's not available for color. This thing is something which it's shipping in some selected OEMs. And it combines this thing with the conventional LCD technology. So half of your pixel is light coming in, but half of it is covered by this electrophoric pixel. So you can have it work in your room, but when you go out, you use that electrophoric display. So this is, again, something, these are mostly currently very far out from commercialization. This is a company which came from University of Cincinnati. And the way this works is you have a liquid, and it's response to the electrical signal you apply. And again, this is readable in sunlight. This is the most coolest one, but the farthest away from commercialization is just you have one photonic crystal, and you change the size of it depending upon what voltage you apply. And just one crystal can generate either red, green, or blue. So, and then you need to have a X factor finally. You know, you need to fold it out, or you know, it has to roll into something, or something cool has to happen with it, right? So some of these enable flexible displays as well.